dear? I wish you'd sing with us.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
And do we always have something to rejoice and be glad in?
Yes.
Absolutely, that we get to gather together in God's house of worship, and we get to come outside of the, well, it's only 87 degrees out there right now, so that's not so bad. But the last couple of days has been really, really hot. So glad to have everybody coming in here. So glad to have our Facebook Live friends joining us right now, as well as those that are watching the recordings on Facebook Live and on YouTube and Epworth Channel 6. And as always, thank you to Epworth for rebroadcasting our service on their channel every day. So glad to have everybody else here with us. Now, if you're visitors with us during the Passing the Peace, I invite you to find a visitor card in the back. Fill it out, put it in your offering plate, so that way we have a record of your visit. With everybody else, we can tell you're here, except for those of you who are watching Facebook Live. Make a comment that you're there, like, hey, I'm here. And that way we know that you're here and we get a recording. Otherwise, we just get a number. So now, as we're doing all that, I'm going to turn it over to Jan, who's got some announcements for us.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Glad to have everybody here today. If you'll go to the back of your bulletin, you will see that here we are meeting on the 25th, but if you'll look, Tuesday the 27th, we have Soup Kitchen again. If you have not helped with Soup Kitchen, you need to do it, because it is a wonderful experience. Marty's leading us this week, and if you want to come and help us, at 9:30 we'll be cooking, at 11 we'll start serving, but it's wonderful to watch those people, and they're really grateful. They tell us thank you a lot. Hardly any complaints. Anyway, come join us. On Wednesday, there will probably not be Stitches of Love because Carolyn's gone and Jan's being lazy. But youth is at 5:30. 7 o'clock is choir practice. And we will meet back here again. Any more joys? Concerns?
I guess this is a joy. Hopefully, I'm just going crazy. Anybody would like to come out and pick me up?
Okay. Robert Buser has a plethora of okra.
Can you spell that?
Yes, I can. P-L-E-T-R-T-H-R-A. Anyway, he has a whole bunch, and he would love to have somebody come out with long sleeves on and gloves, please, because I itch like crazy. I'm allergic to it. And pluck it away, because he'll show you where that patch is. And if you don't know where Robert's house is, he'll tell you. Let's pass the peace.
I only said that because one time I said plethora. You said, yeah, but can you spell it?
And you can.
Did you remember that?
Yes, I did. That's why I said that.
Shame on me. Yeah. Of course.
Thank you.
morning. How are you doing?
I'm good. How are you doing?
I'm good. I'm good.
We're glad to see you here.
I'm glad to be here.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord has made. That the Lord has made. We will rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad. Good morning, everyone. Let's remain standing and sing our first hymn, Standing on the Promises. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. I will shout and sing, standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call. Resting in my Savior as my all in all. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Will you join me in the call to worship? Let us praise God, all people of faith, for God has richly blessed us in all things.
God's ways are known in all the world. God's saving power among all nations.
God dawns on us like the morning light, like sun flowing forth on a cloudless morning.
God sends the rain that waters the earth.
God rules justly over all creation. Will you pray with me? Lord, thank you so much for this beautiful day, for all that you give us. Pour your Spirit over us as we are together at this time, and help us to take your word and live those words in our lives. Help us be faithful and wonderful servants to you always. And let us keep in mind all of these people that need us. We pray this in your Son's holy name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated, and while you're finding your seat, I invite you to find in your bulletin, toward the bottom of the first half to the top part of the next half, our list of our concerns and joys. And as always, that first part of the list is people who are dealing with ongoing medical concerns, like battling cancer. I invite you to please take that list home with you so you can pray with them daily. And then on the rest of the other issues, we'll see if we have any updates or additions. Christy Jarnigan, I contacted her. She had her cataract surgery, and it went well, but she was still dealing with the uncomfort part of the medicine and floaties that comes with the cataract surgery. So we want to keep her in our prayers. Her next surgery isn't until the middle of September. because you know they don't do both eyes at the same time, which is very wise. And David McLaren was here. Did they have to go home? Yeah, he wasn't going to come at all, so I'm glad he came some, but he came to elders in Sunday school, and that's probably wiped him out. So he had successful surgery on his thumb. They chiseled away some of his bones and pulled his tendon around and reconnected it. I mean, it sounds really, really bad. More major than he thought it was going to be, too. At least longer than he thought it was going to be. So we need to continue to pray for his healing. Any other updates that we have? Any additions that we need to add? Wow. Okay. And now we know those of you that are watching online, we can't hear you, but we know that God can hear because God hears all things. So we invite you to speak those out loud as we go before our Lord in this time of prayer. Most amazing and beautiful God, we ask that you fill us from the inside out with your Spirit, that calming Spirit that says, yes, we know the world outside is always loud, noisy, filled with all sorts of bad news and bad things going on. Help us, God, for a minute to just shut out that world and just be in your presence. Your presence that gives us strength to do the things that are right for us to do in accordance with your will, not the will of the world, but in showing your love and your compassion to all of your creation. And in an effort to do that, God, we've carved out this time during worship to list our concerns and to add in our joys. Hear our prayers, God, for your children, our brothers and sisters, our family members, our friends, our loved ones that are dealing with ongoing medical concerns, and those that are going on with some current medical concerns that we know that we can only endure through your strength and your love. Be that light that shines into that darkness that wants to surround us. But God, you've also given us a task as your followers to bring that light into the darkness of the world itself. So help us, God, to know what to say and what to do and how to be present for those that are in need. Help us to hear your voice and to share that voice with the world. For this we bring before you in and through the name of our Lord and Savior, in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Invite our deacons at this time to make their way to the back of the sanctuary as we prepare to receive our offering. Something that some of you may or may not know, but when we have youth church camps, and they start from second grade all the way up to high school, the practice that we started when I came here, I don't know how it was before I came in 2005, but the practice we do here is I don't make families come and say, we need help financially for our kids to go to camp. What we do here is the church pays for our youth to go to camp, and if a parent wants to make a contribution toward that, then that's between them and God. So every year I let the campers know that they go to church camp because of the love of this church and the offerings that people give throughout the year. Some people give always to the camp program. So now, this happens every time. As our youth get older, they go get jobs, then I don't get to see them as much. But some of our youth that went to camp, I haven't seen all summer because we didn't have youth group, but we had our first youth group back Wednesday. And so they can't come to church on Sunday mornings because they've got jobs on Sunday mornings. This thing's happened. So I said, you know what? You need to say thank you to the church. So
thank you for sending us to camp.
Thank you for sending us to camp.
And we had a really fun time.
It was really enjoyable. We learned many lessons.
And we had a lot of fun.
My favorite part about camp was definitely the night swim and seeing everyone interact with each other in positive ways.
My favorite part was Gaga Ball in ninth grade. And the food was
okay.
It was okay. Last year was better.
Yeah. Thank you. Bye.
So, yeah, that's awesome. That round of applause for that. Yeah, they did good. We also sent Mason, but she didn't come to church on to youth group Wednesday night. But I'm sure she would add the same thank you. Because of your generosity, we can do so many wonderful things in this community and touch lives. So think of these things and others as the plates are passed. Thank you. Indeed, God, we give you thanks because you've already blessed us in so many wonderful ways and asked us to be a blessing to others. So from the blessing that you've given to us, we offer back a portion for your ministry. We ask, God, that you bless our efforts to make it enough to make a difference in this world for your glory. In Christ's name, amen. You may be seated.
Yeah. If I've got stuff, just step over me. Would you please stand in honor of God's word? Our scripture today comes from John 6, 55 through 69. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate, and they died, but the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you, there are some who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, 'For this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father.' Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, 'Do you also wish to go away?' Simon Peter answered him, 'Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God.' The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
What a clap.
may be seated.
She was about done at that point. Gravity is a wonderful, consistent thing in our world. Okay, when I first went into seminary, right off the bat, I got swooped up by some of the camp counselors, the directors, who were looking for some new blood. And I was young, haven't done a camp before, and they were just excited. So next thing you know, that first summer, I was doing church camps. Had no clue what I was doing, but I got to do some. Matter of fact, my first camp counselor, co-counselor, was Misty, at that time was Misty Klein, who later became Misty Sturgeon. Or did I get that backwards? I got that backwards. But she was the youth pastor here in the 90s, I believe. And she was my first co-counselor. And so we learned a lot about doing camp. And right off the bat, the kids all said that we were the cool counselors. Well, part of it was is because we were near their age, and we knew what they wanted, and you know, we wanted to give it to them because we wanted to stay those cool counselors. And then shortly after that, I got my first youth group, and some of those kids that were at camp are my youth group, and they were telling them, oh, he's the cool guy. So then I was the cool youth minister because I knew what they wanted, and I was able to give it to them because I wanted to keep that cool status. You know, I wanted to be known as the cool youth pastor. Now, Jesus, he was the cool rabbi at the time. He was young, up and coming, had some new thoughts. He wasn't like those other stick-in-the-mud type of rabbis. He let them pick grain on a Sabbath day and eat it. He let them, he healed people on the Sabbath day, even though all those stick-in-the-muds were like, no, you can't heal them. He's like, I'm going to heal them anyway. He was the cool rabbi. But in our text today that Jan just read for us, Jesus went too far. In his imagery of what he talked about, he went too far. And some of his followers took offense to that imagery. This idea we talked about last week of eating his flesh and drinking his blood and how gross that sounded. They took offense to that. But if you think about it, many people at that time were convinced that Jesus was crazy. He was out of his mind. He was, even some of his own family members thought that he had lost it. And many people were saying that he was able to do the works that he did by the power of Beelzebub, the prince of demons. There was far more arguments that Jesus was crazy than there were arguments that he really was the Son of God. It was easier to believe the others. And so, and all that was dancing in the back of the minds of his followers. Then all of a sudden, their leader got up and said, "Eat of my flesh and drink of my blood." And they were like, maybe he really is a little bit too far out there. Now, Jesus did not come to earth to win popularity contests. He didn't come to be the cool rabbi. He could have worked the system. He could have gone through the proper channels. He could have gone to the schools and became a member of the Jewish leadership. He could have been one of them and liked and well respected. He could have been one of their buddies. But he didn't come for any of that stuff. He came to lead them. He came to buck the system, not become part of it. He came to lead and not to follow. He came to call us all to task. And that's a sign of a true leader. One who knows where they want to go and where they lead the people to get there. And a true leader has convictions and sticks to those convictions even when obstacles come their way. Now, see, for many of Jesus' followers, they really wanted Jesus to be a little bit different. They really wanted him to be more like King David. They really wanted him to restore the kingdom of David. And after the feeding of the 5,000 plus the women and children, they went after him to make him king. And if you might recall, what he did was he snuck away so that they couldn't do that because he didn't come here for that reason. But it's always easier to lead people in the direction they want to go than to lead them in the direction they should go. It's always easier. I mean, which is easier, to get children to eat Brussels sprouts or brownies? I mean, that's just the way it is in life. But easy was not the way of Jesus. He knew the message he had for them was a hard message for them to follow and that there was going to be many obstacles in the way. But he had a conviction to teach them these things no matter what the cost was going to be. And the people did not accept it. And it said in our scripture, many walked away. And they didn't come back. Jesus lost followers. Now, is this a text about Jesus' failure? No. not at all. I'm sure Jesus would have loved for them all to have stayed. He didn't ask them to leave. He'd rather they'd stayed with him. And how great he would have been. He would have been so happy had they decided to stay. He wasn't so worried, though, for them to stay so that he could be that cool rabbi. You see, at that youth group, I learned, and the same thing about church camp, was that I wanted to stay that cool youth minister, so I kind of let them get away with things I probably shouldn't have let them get away with. But they kept reinforcing it by saying, "Boy, you're so cool, you let us do these things." Well, then one afternoon, one of the parents said, "Hey, I want to be a sponsor." And I said, "Great." So they came, and she was a retired school teacher. Yeah. So there's 23-year-old Michael running around with these kids, just running amok during youth group, doing whatever they wanted to do. And she, didn't take long, said, "You all stop it right now." And they all stopped. And she gathered them in and started to lecture them. And I thought, oh, she's not going to be the cool. She's going to be the Wicked Witch of the West. You know, they're never going to want her to come back here at all. I'm going to still be the cool youth minister. When the kids all said, "Yes, ma'am." And I thought, well, that's not the response I thought they were going to give. And then when we had our closing prayer, one of the kids said, "Thank you, God, for sending Miss," whatever, I can't remember her name now, who stuck us to the task and put us in our place. And I thought, what in the world? They enjoyed that. And so not only did the youth learn that night, I learned that night that my job wasn't to be the cool youth minister. And so I took that to heart. And then next summer when I did church camp and some of the kids came back and like, "Oh, he's the cool guy." They thought it was okay at the camp at nighttime in the cabin. The boys like to tell jokes. I don't know if the girls do, but the boys tell jokes and it gets bad. And they started to tell racial jokes. And some of them were really bad racial jokes. Now, old me would have said, I don't want to lose my cool status. But the new me said, it's more important they respect me. So I stood up and I said, "Guys, that's not funny." I said, "That's actually just nothing but mean." And they said, "You know, you're right." And so I was still the cool counselor, but now I was respected counselor. Jesus wasn't worried about being the most popular rabbi around. He had convictions and he stood up for them. He had a job to do. And they left because they didn't like what he had to say. So be it. He wasn't going to change his message just to keep them there. He needed to show them what it meant to follow. Not their agenda, but God's agenda. Not their will, but God's will. But to truly follow, even when the direction that God wants us to go is sometimes not the one that we want to go, but it's the one we need to go. And it's not always the popular one. Peter took to heart that lesson that day. The same lesson I learned that day at my first youth group. Given an easy way out in verse 67, Jesus turned to him and said, "Do you all wish to go away as well?" They could have said, "Sure," and left and went back to their lives. But no, Peter said, "Lord, to whom can we go?" What, a more popular rabbi? No, to whom can we go? "Because you have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and to know that you are the Holy One of God." In other words, Peter was saying, "I don't care. If you're the fun or the cool rabbi, what I care about is that you have a powerful message from God, and I want to hear more about that and put it into my life." All filled with humanity's faults and all, Peter was willing to follow Jesus even when it wasn't popular. Peter stood up and he spoke out loud. One among so many who were leaving that day, he stood up. Never underestimate, church, never underestimate the power that one person can have when they stand up for their convictions and lead. Peter stood up, and it was like a beacon to the others that, hey, we could stand up too, even when it's not popular. He stood up, even when it wasn't cool. And he chose not the easy path, but he chose God's path for his life. And the others, they did likewise. They followed suit after Peter stood up. One man among so many. And that one man's actions helped keep that little band of disciples together. Those 12 disciples made up not of super disciples, but of just disciples, just followers, just people like you and me, filled with the same limitations, but also filled with the same love of God, filled with the same hesitations, but the same potential, filled with the same doubt, as well as the same convictions that we have in our own hearts. This band of misfits stayed together, had already had a list of failures, and they were going to add more to them as they watched Jesus get arrested, tried, and crucified. They all scattered. But Peter stood up that day for his convictions, and he spoke up, and they found themselves staying and not leaving with the others. The power of one, church, can make a huge difference in this world. Today, right now, we face, and every day, we face that same potential of the need to stand up for our convictions and tell the world we're not following the way that you want us to go. We're following the way God wants us to go. And the opportunity to stand up and to speak up. But you may say, I'm just one person. Look what one person can do. With Peter-like conviction, church, we've got to take a stand and say, this is not right. What we're doing is not right. That just might be what the others around us might need to see. But so many are leaving the church. So many are looking for an easier way. Looking for an easier theology, a black and white theology that's spoon-fed to them. And so many are looking for entertainment instead of for worship. A message that they could not have to think about, but just take in. And Jesus turns our way every day, church, and says, do you wish to leave also? When the world says there's way far more things you could do on Sunday morning, do you wish to leave? When the world says there's so much easier things to do, just give in. Do what we say. And Jesus says, do you want to leave as well? Well, church, what answer through our actions are we going to give Jesus today? Amen?
Amen.
Sometimes we have to know when to stand up for our convictions. Also, sometimes we have to know when to say, I need help. I have a laptop that the battery's been shot on it for years. And I took it to the Apple store and I said, can you all replace this battery? And they said, sure, for $250.
Right.
And that laptop's 9 years old. It still works fine. It's just the battery shot on it. And they said, we hate to do that to you because your laptop's only worth $200. And I'm like, if I was going to sell it, but I don't want to sell it. But I thought, I can't pay $250. So I let it go. And then I saw something on social media, TikTok, Instagram, one of those things. I don't do Facebook, but I do those others. And someone was like talking about replacing their battery. I thought, oh, let me look into that. They wanted $250. The battery I can get on Amazon for $45 and a YouTube video of how to install it. So there you go. I watched this YouTube video. Now I'm as a master, and I knew exactly what to do. I watched a YouTube video. And so I took the back off of my laptop. I put this battery I got from Amazon for $45 in there. And the guy said, yeah, now you just need to do is remove the flex cable that connects the battery to the computer. And he just went like this. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I just went like that. And the back of that cable looked a lot different than on the new battery. And so I looked at it closer. I pulled off the part that connects the cable to the motherboard that helps it communicate. And so I was sitting there looking. I was like, this isn't right. So I looked online. We have a repair shop here in town. So I went to go find them. And you have to know when to ask for help sometimes. So these are people who are way more experts at this. And they said, yeah, you can't fix that. He said, you pulled the cable, the copper cables out of that. We can send it off to somebody. And they can re-solder it back on. It'll take a couple of weeks. And he goes, I don't even know how much they're going to charge you for this 9-year-old laptop. And I said, will the battery still work? And they said, it's just not going to communicate to your computer. He goes, but, you know, you can still plug it in the wall. And the battery may or may not work. Well, guess what? The battery doesn't work. But the computer still came on. I was excited when I turned it on, and it came back on. And so now I just have to keep it plugged in the wall, which is what I've had to do for the last couple of years because the battery's been shot anyway. So I'm back to where I was, only $45 poor. But I did learn a lesson that sometimes we need to know when a YouTube video does not make us an expert. Sometimes we need to know when we have to go to help. And it was reassuring to me to know there's someone out there who knew. It's reassuring to me to know that when the world seems dark and depressing and things like that, when it seems like the world's message is too powerful to do the easy way, that I can go to my Lord and Savior who says, it's going to be okay. Come to the table. Eat of the bread and drink of the cup and realize that we get to be in the presence of Jesus every day, who is an expert in all things of the world. Know when to go for help and to come to the table. For all believers are invited to partake. As we prepare to receive our Holy Communion, I'll turn over to Crystal to lead us in our communion hymn.
Let's sing together, Eat This Bread.
Eat this bread, drink this cup, come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup, trust in me and you will not thirst. Eat this bread, drink this cup, come to me and never be hungry. Eat this bread, drink this cup, trust in me and you will not thirst.
On the night when our Lord and
Savior was gathered there with the disciples at that first Last Supper, he took the bread from the table. He lifted it toward heaven to give thanks. But this time he said, this is no longer ordinary bread, for this is my body that I give unto you. Eat of it in remembrance of me. In a like manner, he poured out some wine. And as he did, he said, this is no longer ordinary wine, for this is my life-giving blood that I pour out freely for you, so that you can understand what true forgiveness is all about, so that we can be in a covenant that's based on love. He said, drink of this in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of the bread and we drink of the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. Let us pray.
Our dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day, a beautiful day, and we thank you that we're alive to enjoy it. We thank you for this bread, bread of life, that you give us as a symbol of your body. We love our love for you, and we greatly appreciate all the blessings you give us to all of your children.
Dear God, thank you for this cup that represents our Lord and Savior Jesus, who died on a cross for us. This cup is more than just sacrifice. It is love. It is a new covenant given to us by our Savior. We pray this in your Son's holy name. Amen. Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Let us pray. O God of love and of mercy, who've gathered us together at your table of remembrance and of fellowship, as we gather here, we are also reminded that some of our church members are physically unable to join us due to physical limitations. We ask God for your blessings upon our Agape ministry as they extend the table of remembrance and fellowship to our homebound. So that way, God, we may all partake of the elements and be reminded of your love for us that took the form of our Lord and Savior, who came into this world just as us, as a baby, who grew up and taught us how to live our lives and taught us how to find our way home. The least we can do is to remember the prayer that he taught us so long ago. As we blend our voices together, may your ears find it pleasing as we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our sins, as we forgive those who've sinned against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. What a wonderful morning it's been to be together and to worship again. Matter of fact, let's do it again next Sunday and every Sunday. And I hope everybody comes back and bring a friend or two. Glad to have some visitors with us today that we haven't had for a while. And hope you all come back as well. We're glad to have those of you who've tuned in online. Hope that you will continue as well. But we also have a couple things I want to say before we close up our service. One is... in your bulletin, I wanted to point out, because I wanted you all not to miss it, at the bottom of the back, there's a nice thank you note from Jan Hansen to the church for people who support her in her recovery. So I wanted to make sure you saw that. Don't forget, Tuesday is our soup kitchen day. And if you want to help in the kitchen, be there at 9:30, 10-ish. If you want to help serving, be there around 11:15, 11:30-ish. We start at 11:30, so. And it's a great experience. Also, I want to say thank you. Great to have the choir back. Thank you all for bringing the choir back together. Wasn't that great to have the choir back? Woo! And there's room for more. So if you want to join the choir, please come on Wednesdays. We love to have you. And we're meeting down right here. If you want to come on Wednesdays, be here at 7 o'clock down here. We'd love to have you come and sing with us. Also, I put this in the newsletter for September. I don't remember if it made it in August. But our region is putting a plea out. There's a search committee for the next regional minister out there. And part of the process of looking for the regional minister is they do what they call listening sessions, where they want to go around and there's separate different groups, and they want to hear from the regional congregation, that's you all, what they think the strengths of the region is or what our weaknesses are, what can we be some of those goals, and what would we like to have in the next regional minister. So they set this up, and they wanted us to let you all know. The one closest to us will be in Lawton, and that will be on September the 14th, but at 1 o'clock in Lawton, at First Christian Church in Lawton. If you can't make that, then there's going to be a statewide Zoom meeting, and that's going to be on September the 7th. So that's just in a couple of weeks, actually. Next week is September 1st, and then after that will be the 7th. So that'll be at 1 o'clock by Zoom. And I'll get the information. They haven't sent me the Zoom link yet. If they do that, then I'll send it out to everybody if you want to be a part of that. And there's others, and I put the whole schedule in next month's bulletin. I mean, newsletter. Blah. But I will put it in the bulletin as well. So, and Labor Day is coming up. That is. So the Monday after Labor Day will be closed. Thank you, Daniel. I got to make note of that. So, yeah, I got to make note of that. Thank you, Daniel. Okay, are there any other announcements before we go from this place? I think we covered them all. As we go from this place, now, God has given us an experience, and we are called to respond to that experience. If it's been through hearing the word or heard it preached or heard the music, we are called to respond. Now, for some of us, that response is to come forward and place your membership in this congregation by transfer from another or to make public your confession of faith. If that's how you're called to respond this morning, then as we sing our closing song, I will be here to receive you. Just come on down as soon as we start singing. Those of you who are watching online, just message me, reach out to me, let me know that's your intention, and we can make that happen virtually. But we can all respond, because if that's not how you're called to respond today, then you can respond by singing as joyfully as you can our closing song, where I turn it over to Crystal to lead us in.
Let's stand and sing together, My Hope Is Built.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When He shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand.